Can I bring this back? Yo, Nikki, can I bring this back one more time? Can I bring this back?
Come on, man. If you don't do it, you fired.
No, you're cool.
Yeah, I know. I think you're fired.
Con una tiquenera, papi, yo no son medusa. No, no, qué cojones. Nicky
gata está con cojones. Cada 6 meses llega una guagua. Una guagua nueva y una mansión. Con una guagua nueva y una mansión. Thank you, man. Thank you, man. I haven't done a freestyle in a long time, you know?
Yo, it brings back like the Hunger Days, like putting mixtapes out and kicking ass and selling them shits and getting a Lambo from an artist like you and shit. Like, this shit is crazy, man. You got everybody bugging the fuck out, man. It's just mind-boggling. Like, I was watching a Netflix series, like, all the shit that you went through. And now you're stuck somewhere because of the coronavirus. You can't even, like, market this shit in America. But it came out in the Spanish market first, right?
Yeah, it was in the Spanish market first a year ago. And, you know, but I think it's a good... I mean, I would have rather... for it to come out all around the world.
Yeah.
But it feels good because it feels like it's brand new again, you know, and it's killing the game and everybody's crazy about it. It was top 10 in the United States on Netflix. So, I mean, it can't be bigger than that. Like, I was always watching on Netflix and I saw it said top 10 US. So I was like, what?
That's crazy. You know? When you see that, you know it's over.
You know everybody's on it. You know what I'm saying?
Was it like a coincidence that it came out during the Bad Boys like pre-hype, or was it scheduled?
No, nah, man. You know, the thing is, it was going to come out on Telemundo. And for some reason, because Netflix like negotiated with Telemundo or something like that. And for some reason, it was too strong for Telemundo. You know, it had a lot of...
Yeah, it's gritty. It's gritty. Oh, my God.
Yeah, you know, but that's the way we wanted it. So, you know, the kids in the streets could get it, you know what I'm saying, and understand what's going on. If you don't do a graphic for these kids, they don't care about it. They don't want, you know what I'm saying?
It's mind-boggling that you literally had to blow up to see your mom, man. That's crazy. Yeah, your goal was to be famous, to go see your mom?
Yeah, that's all I wanted, bro. I mean, I had love for the music, but... Yeah. As soon as I saw that I had the talent, my mentality was not even about making the money and making all this. I was like, I'm trying to be famous so my mom could see me. You know what I'm saying?
So you could get past the political shit that she got deported to DR.
So you needed, she got deported.
Wow, that's crazy, yo. I've never heard this before, like, ever.
Yeah,
like, that's like partially your goal.
Yeah, my dad moved to Puerto Rico. And I mean, he went to Puerto Rico as a fugitive to raise us because they caught him with 25 kilos of cocaine with an undercover cop that was with us like for almost a year. He was chilling with us in the crib and everything.
Nah.
And my dad was doing his thing, you know what I'm saying? Trying to get that money, trying to like the wrong way. And the guy ended up sending, you know, going with him to the state, to Maine, this place called Maine by Massachusetts. And, They the same guy turned on him and arrested him.
Isn't it crazy how it affected your life and you went through like fucked up times because of that situation where you see it like Tekashi just did $2 million on his shit and then he's just chilling. Like,
not the oh, same, he did the li- he did the live already.
He did the live. He had like $2 million on it.
Oh my God, crazy, crazy. That's a lot. Crazy. I imagined that was gonna go like that.
Man, but you know, you're used to it because you doing music. I think when you have like 20 million views, that means your song failed. You be having like a billion views.
Yeah,
I think that's crazy.
Yeah,
like,
I
you
mean,
and J Balvin, like, come on, man.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's I think it was written for me to have these hits. God wanted me to be
a billion views, though. A billion.
So I could reach people and show my story, you know what I'm saying?
Yo, that shit is crazy.
That tell me about yourself. That flag, that flag.
Oh, I'm Haitian.
Oh, you Haitian? So you Haitian from Haiti?
Yeah.
Okay. So you're Dominican then?
Yeah. So you know Jesse stuck because of the coronavirus in DR. So
yeah,
it's crazy how we all like interconnected, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. That's what's up, man.
Yo, so we're
Do they listen to my music over there?
Huh?
Do they listen to my music over there?
Man, are you out of your mind? Are you crazy right now?
I would love to do a show over there, man.
Can I just play one joint so I can make all the girls go crazy? Let me just play one joint, man.
Let's do it.
Come on, man. Fuck that shit, man. I got you on here. Nigga. Come on, man. Nigga, you fucking dead.
Aquel día te vi y tú en el día sentí. Desde solo te quiero lejos de mí. Sé que no sabes de mí y no te puedo mentir. Lo que dicen en la calle sobre mí.
Y no te voy a negar. Estamos claro y ya.
That's crazy.
No te lo voy a negar.
Damn, son of a bitch.
Estamos claro y ya. Estamos claro y ya.
Hula.
Lo que he visto en el mundo a mí no es normal. Pero no te preocupes que soy anormal. Sé que tus amigas no tenemos mucha. Pero inventale, parte volvante. Como tenemos el que te quito el estrés. Dale otra vez y no te voy a negar.
Hola, búscame el cajón. Tengo las llaves. Ay, no,
estamos claro y ya. No te lo voy a negar. Estamos claro y ya.
No. Yo, it's amazing, man, how you came such a long way, man.
Crazy, man.
In the documentary, you showcased that you gained weight from, like, doing drugs and shit like that. Like, you were at the lowest of the low, huh?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, because the thing is, the drug that I did all kinds of drugs. I did cocaine, I did weed and all that shit. But what I really got hooked on was perks. And for some reason, perks, these pills, these painkillers make you eat. You know what I'm saying? So I was a drug addict. I was a drug addict with weight on. You know, I was a fat drug addict. I was you know what I'm saying? Like, in a way, I was kind of like, you know, like kind of like jealous of these crackheads. You know what I'm saying? Being skinny and slim and shit. Like, damn, man, this drug doesn't do the same thing.
300 pounds.
300 pounds, my brother. I mean, you know, you got to understand this. You're depressed, man. You got nothing to do. All you do is doing drugs.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? These pills made me just be in my house and eat and watch TV and take the pills and eat and watch TV. I didn't do anything, bro. You know, and the thing is, when you become an addict, you know what I'm saying? You get an addict. You become an addict in all kinds of things. You know what I'm saying? Food, liquor, everything. And, you know, some people smoke cigarettes and get skinny. I wasn't that guy. I just got big.
I got to stop watching porn. I be watching too much porn. You know, I don't know. I got websites.
I was on that too, bro. Yo, I was hooked on that. Yeah. And so imagine that. It was self-destruction, bro. That porn is crazy because then you want to make your girl do all kinds of weird shit.
Yo, that's it. It's quite your best.
So, you be like taking pictures of it, like, babe, you gotta do this.
Your drug addiction, because you were part of a group with Daddy Yankee back in the day, so that fucked up your relationship with Daddy Yankee, and you could see that in the series, like.
Yeah, in that moment it fucked it up because I was just getting in too much problems, and he was in that moment where he was like, he already went through that crazy time before. So he was in the moment where he was already like with the discipline, you know, like doing things right. He already did the street shit. He was already, you know, crazy in one moment. And he was trying to like, once he saw that we had hits, he's like, okay, like we got to go straight. And I wasn't going straight. I was with that street
shit. You were young. Too.
And I was the street. Young. I was the street stupid kid. He was the street smart kid.
Oh, wow.
You know what I'm saying? He was the boss mentality. You know what I'm saying? I was the stupid, ignorant kid. So that's you saw where that take me and you saw where that take him.
That's crazy. And then I know doing the Bad Boy movie, it was a great reunion because they got both of y'all back together. Like with the
I mean, we was already back together. But we were doing remixes and shit, but to do a song, yeah.
Yeah, publicly, yeah. To get the song done. How was that moment? Like...
Playing Skills, that, you know, shout out to Playing Skills if they seeing this. They geniuses, man. They did the Con Calma, and that was a hit, you know what I'm saying? And funny thing is they come to my studio to do some work and they show me this song and I'm like, yo, this song is insane. Automatically I said, that a Yankee. He has to be on this track.
Oh, wow.
So we was crossing fingers that he liked it because Yankee's kind of like, you know, picky for his music. And Playing Skills were like, trust me, man. Yankee, everything I say is a hit. He goes for it. I'm like, all right. Gave him a song and, you know, it was a hit, bro. It did real good.
Isn't it crazy that when you guys like combine, it's almost like a nuclear explosion and you have like... of like billions of eyes and ears zoning in on y'all energy. Like, how does that feel? Like, for a person like you, how does that feel? Like, you drop this shit and it's out, and you know how the matrix bends.
Yeah, it feels good. You know, you're cooking something, and then you're watching people eat the food that you cook. You know, and it's good to see when they go when they do this. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, like your face is like the typical chef. Like my chef back here, when she does something for me, she look at my face and then she goes like, okay, he liked it. That's how we, I kind of thought like, okay, so that's how I feel when I do music. Oh my God, I just realized I got the biggest pimple right now on my forehead.
Yo, it's so high def today, man.
Yeah, bro. I mean, I think I gotta pay taxes for those pimples, man.
You gotta drink some water or something, man. Get some water in this shit.
Bro. I don't know, man. You know, it's probably the stress of that Rona, bro.
Stop drinking that Coquito and all that shit over there.
Man. No, I'm telling you, bro. Like, it came to a moment where I was so scared of getting it that I was getting sick just thinking about it.
Yeah. Some people, yeah, it's like anxiety, like sickness.
Yeah, like you didn't want to touch anybody and you were scared. I said, you know what? Fuck it. You know what I'm saying? Fuck it. I'm just going to live my life and, you know, try to take care of myself the most I can, but I'm not going to think about this shit. I'm going to go crazy.
Yeah. You and Tororo, like, explain that relationship real quick for the people out there. So he's about to come on.
You don't understand, man. First of all, how you guys are gonna do it to get him on? Like, you could do it three.
Oh no, we only two. He's coming on after. So.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So this is the thing. I seen what Tororo has done. I already heard before I met him that he did. He was in the Juice movie. You know what I'm saying? I heard that he did the Soul Plane movie with Snoop Dogg and Kevin Hart. He was the first one to do a comedy movie with Kevin Hart. So
and he did all 50 shit. He did Wangsta.
I didn't know about that. I knew about that.
He did Many Men. In my mentality,
he was already a legend. So when I met him, and he did a bunch of hits, videos with Wisin y Yandel. So when I meet this guy, I'm over here thinking, I wish he could see in me what I have. I wish he could see the talent that I have. Because I'm like, I always wanted to be a director since I was a kid. And I'm sorry. So my mentality is like, he gave me a script for a video. He gave me an idea for a video where I had to do a little bit of acting, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
when he seen me acting in this video, he was like, yo, Nicki, I'm gonna tell you something, bro. Like, you a natural, bro. Like, you should do, like, you should be acting, bro. And I'm like inside saying, fuck yes. You know what I'm saying? Like, he got it. He seen what I got. And he told me, I'm gonna have you under consideration. I mean, if I meet anybody, if there's any movies or anything, I'm gonna let you know. And you know how people tell you shit like that, and you're like, yeah,
yeah,
you know what I'm saying? Because it's like too much. Bro, I'm not lying. A year later, dude calls me, tells me, I got you for the Vin Diesel movie, XXX.
What?
I was like, what the fuck? I'm like,
get the fuck out of here.
And he's like, yeah, man. And he showed me, they showed me the script, you know what I'm saying? And because obviously Vin went to him. And Vin Diesel knows that Jesse works with reggaeton artists, and they wanted somebody from the Spanish market to be on the movie. You know, they were working the movie in a very technical way. You know what I'm saying? They had Neymar from Brazil. They had, like, this guy from China. So I was, like, the Spanish face for this movie. So my first acting gig was a toe-to-toe with Vin Diesel. And I'm not talking about, hey, how you doing? No, I'm talking about an argument. Long-ass argument about a negotiation about guns and all that shit. And we're talking about 20%. You crazy? 20%? Bah, 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 bah. Like,
you got to remember the lines and then the action scene all in one day.
That's not that, bro. When the dude comes in, you know what I'm saying? The dude comes in, this motherfucker tall, man. It's like he, like, I mean, people think he's not that tall probably because they've seen him next to The Rock. And The Rock is,
yeah,
like,
yeah, he mad cool, too.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Ben is mad cool. It's my brother, man. It's my his kids call me uncle.
Yo,
he's
word.
My family. Yeah, yo, man, they love me. So the thing is that I'm seeing this guy. He gets in a helicopter in Dominican. We were shooting in Dominican Republic. He gets in a helicopter. It's my first time seeing Vin Diesel, and I'm practicing my lines. And when I see him, I'm like, oh my fucking god! I can't believe I'm about to see this guy, and he came to me exactly the same voice. I'm like, shit, man. And then he's like, we was doing it like it was the first time me in front of a whole bunch of professional directors. I mean, there was $200 million there right now. And they're like, okay, Nick, you ready? You ready? Action. Boom. And he comes in, bro. And they saw how I went in, you know what I'm saying? And everybody looked, and everybody like, that's not bad for a first time, but Nicki, I need you to come with me real quick. Like, he pulled me aside, Ben, and he said, like, I like that you know your lines really good, but I need you to own those lines like they're yours. Forget about the script. Do it how Nicki Jam would have done it if he was in the hood. You know what I'm saying? Somebody approached him. Wow. And that's what you got to do with all the scripts, because you got to understand, people that write these scripts are just white boys from, you know what I'm saying? They are nerds, you know what I'm saying? They don't got that street slang. Mm. So I want you to do what you got to do. So that's what I did. You know what I'm saying? That's what I did, bro, and I killed it. And I got to thank Jesse Torero for that. Like, Jesse Torero got me in the movie industry. He believed in me. He told people about me. And now we got this number one movie all over the world. That's Bad Boys 3 with Will Smith. And I'm doing a toe-to-toe with Will Smith. And not only, it's not a cameo, I'm almost in all the movie.
The whole thing, yo. Yo, the action scenes, I don't know how you even did that shit, man.
Man.
The motorcycle shit?
No, that motorcycle I did.
You know how to ride a motorcycle like that?
Yeah. I did everything. The only thing I didn't do was the part where we jumped from the second floor to the bar.
Oh, stunt double. That was a stunt double.
That was a stunt. Hell
yeah. Yeah, you ain't fucking your shit up.
I'm too old for that shit. Yeah, motorcycle. I've been doing motorcycles since I was a kid.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? But nah, man, Jesse Torero, I owe him a lot. Mm. You know what I'm saying? And I love the dude. And not only that, he brought to reality the story of my life on Netflix. And we did a series where he made that. Nobody could have done that series better than him.
Yo,
nobody, man, understands the street. Nobody understands a kid that was raised in the States and Puerto Rico like him. Because he's a Dominican. he's a Dominican raised in New York, so he got it. You know what I'm saying? So he made that shit official. And nothing, man. I love him, bro. Jesse Terrero is one of the best directors in the game, most humblest guy in the world, one of the most shortest motherfucker I've ever met.
I know.
And got the deepest voice in the world, too.
He be turning up, too, man. Go take him to y'all. And live, you can wild it out.
We gonna pop off.
Yo, I'm gonna, let's celebrate that movie moment, man. Let's get to this one right here. Oh, man.
Rip your flags out there.
They got my girl moving her booty.
That's a big one too, man. Jesus Christ, man. That's a big one. The relation with Will Smith, how's that? Because I saw y'all performing. People see y'all together a lot. Will Smith, give us a Will Smith.
Nah, man. Will Smith is, he's just what you see, bro. Same guy you see on TV, same guy you see in an interview. He's exactly what you see, bro. He's always active. You know what I'm saying? He's humble. He makes everybody laugh. He's always trying to make people laugh. Mm. He's always trying to make people learn. You know what I'm saying? Like, I think Will Smith's legacy is not really what you see on TV. It's what he is in real life when you meet him. You know what I'm saying?
Okay. Did he make it easy for you for Bad Boys? Like,
Definitely, man.
Yeah.
His attitude. I mean, he's a pro. He's a G. You know what I'm saying? He's been in this for, what, 30 years. He knows what he's doing. He's worked with a lot of people that was starting in the game from the beginning, and so he understands. And I just think he likes people grinding. He likes people in the process. Mm. He's a lovable guy, bro. Like, and he hates the way I eat, too. And he hates that he says I eat disgusting and that I drink too much Coca-Cola. And his son would always take a Coca-Cola from my hand and give me a bottle of water. Like, literally, like, he would, like, see me drink a Coke, and he would pull it off my hand, and he was like, yo, water, Nikki, water. And you know they own that thing, that water thing?
Yeah.
His son owns it. I thought he was just trying to promote his shit, but.
Yeah. Yo, how about Martin Lawrence? Like, did you know him from before?
Bro. For some reason, I was more starstruck to see Martin than Will. Knowing that Will is an icon.
Yeah.
Like, Will is, you can't get bigger than Will, but I was starstruck because Martin was like this guy that would make you think this, you know, we all have like this favorite uncle or cousin that has that personality, you know?
Yeah.
We're always like, what's up? You know, like he would have that vibe everywhere he went. So when I seen him the first day, he was like, you know, you gotta understand, like Martin ain't 20 years old anymore, you know? Yeah.
He ain't doing that no more, right? You mad, right? I'm mad he don't do that shit no more.
That wasn't the vibe that I got. The vibe that I'm not gonna lie. The vibe that I got was more like, it was more like, yeah. You gotta go do this. Okay, yeah, let's go. But very respectful person.
Mm.
He didn't know who I was, and he said hi to me, and very humble. He didn't know nothing about my music, you know what I'm saying? But yeah. That first day when we finished shooting, I think Will told him, like, yo, that's Nicky Jam. He's, like, one of the hottest Spanish singers. Like, look at his following on Instagram. And the guy was like, wow. And then the next day, he's like, yo, impressive what you done, man. Like, there was Martin again. Like, there was a Martin that I was wishing for, you know what I'm saying? And
yo.
After that, it was like more like a uncle and nephew kind of vibe. Like, he's like, hey, how you doing? Good. You know what I'm saying?
How long was the shoot for? It was like a couple of weeks or?
No, man, this is like probably like a couple of months.
Oh, wow. So, y'all practically family. Shit.
That's it. Yeah. Man, different vibe, you know? I mean, you know, he had, Martin had, like, I think he had an accident with his back or something. Mm. Like, he went hard, like, and he still pulled it off because that's how you know he's a pro. Because he was, like, all serious and shit, like, all fucked up. And then when it was said action, it was like, Martin's back.
He's in character. Is that going to lead to, like, you working with Will Smith in other movies? Because, you know, he's constantly...
Well, you know, the idea of working with Will Smith in other movies, I don't think, you know...
Not far.
It's not my... Well, of course, if he calls me for 50 movies, I'm going to do
it. See
ya! Yeah, but the idea is to work with everybody else. You know what I'm saying? The idea is to prove myself. Because I don't want it to look like, oh, well, Nicky got the part because he's in Bad Boys... They don't know I did a casting, bro. Like, I did the whole process, and I had to show myself that I could do it.
Oh, wow.
That's
crazy. A man with 37 million followers still got to do a fucking...
Well, they got to see if you can act, you know what I'm saying? It's very important. And it was three ladies, like, sitting down, you know what I'm saying? Like, three ladies sitting down and checking everything up, you know, like...
Bro, you could promote the whole movie with just your social media. Like,
I know. Crazy. But the movie went great. Yeah. I was happy with my part. You know what I'm saying?
One last question is, why the hell y'all do David Grumman like that, man? That was harsh. That was crazy.
I don't know, man. I just think, you know, David Grumman is one of the most important people from Miami. And
exactly.
Obviously, you know, they want to give love. I mean, you're not going to do a Miami movie and not have David in the movie. You know what I'm saying? And, I mean, I think he looked pretty happy. They put him as a gangster. You know what I'm saying? They shot him. The end of the day, they shot
him. On his boat.
I mean, the end of the day, they shot me too, you know? So we both still alive, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. Zombies in this motherfucker.
The final questions before you disappear in your corona thing is J Balvin. How's that relationship? How did y'all link? Like, and then
come on, bro. Years, bro. We've been friends for years. I lived in Colombia.
Like since almost 15, almost a good 15 years.
A little bit, yeah.
Like probably the reggaeton like hustle. 11
years, probably like 11 to 12 years. Not 15, wow. But 12. Yeah,
that's crazy. How was it to deal with him? He's mad cool. I know him too, but I want to know, like, any.
Man, he's a baby. He don't have any bad bones in his body. You know what I'm saying? Like, he has a kid mentality.
When you guys do music, is it like competitive, or are you guys going with like a vibe?
I don't compete with him. He's my brother, man.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, you know.
We are competition, but it's not like I think of it that way, because the end of the day, like, J Balvin is always ready to do anything for me. So if he goes on top, it's like me being on top too, because then we could do a track anytime. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's the way I see it.
You guys see that, like, when he did the Super Bowl, you saw yourself there too, because all y'all are interconnected.
I mean, I did the World Cup that has even more people. You know what I'm saying? Are you going to talk about
competitive? Yeah, that's competitive. Like,
it's not really competitive. It's more mentality of, like, I can't get mad. You know what I'm saying? Like, I can't get mad because I got one, he got one. You know what I'm saying? You can't get it all. You know what I'm saying?
Like, man.
He's done a lot of things in his career, and I've done a lot of things in my career that I'm happy. I envy a lot of stuff that he does in a good way, and he envy a lot of stuff that I... Every time he sees me, he's like, hi, Hollywood actor. You know what I'm saying? Like, in a very funny way, you know?
You dealing with billions of views and super success, does that... Do you connect with, like, different forms of people? Like super elite, like... What's that world like? Like when you meet them and they kidnap you to do a show, like I hear it's like a different language, different experience when you deal with like let's say if you go to Saudi Arabia, you know you got your music controls all the Arabs and shit because it's obviously like there's no language barrier with reggaeton and Latin music. Like how do they treat you? Or how do you communicate when you meet these people? Is it normal or is it different?
Mostly when I go to these type of shows, I just go to show. I just go to sing. So I do a little bit of a tourist vibe and check out the place. But I don't do interviews there. You know what I'm saying? And somebody's gonna do interviews in English. So.
Oh wow.
Yeah. No, I never had a language problem thing. And the good thing is I speak Spanish and English. So mostly everywhere I go, it's easy for me. You know.
Ozuna, how's that?
That's my brother, man. It's my brother, man. We got a lot of tracks together. We call each other a lot. I bother him a lot. He bullies me a lot. It's just family.
Is it always freestyle mode before y'all get into big records or when y'all leak shit? Is it freestyles or explain to me how these records are done real quick before you go.
Like, is it
a vibe?
You mean when we both do a collab?
Both do a collab or how you guys do music? Like,
the way I do it, I put the melody and I start doing melodies. Like if it's, I'd be like, and then I'd be like, okay, what am I gonna write that goes with that? That's how I do it.
You see, you know, a lot of these, you know, you'd be surprised the questions I got today when I said you're going to be on my live. This is so much shit. They're just wondering how you do everything, like why you're so successful, why your music is what it is. And I'm just trying to get as much as possible. And you answered a lot today, man. I'm so happy you hung out with me more today, man. This is a great experience, man. Anytime, yo, I got to have my El Ganador experience at Live or just come party with you, man, or do some crazy shit. You know what I mean?
That's hell yeah, man. I'm ready for you, bro.
what's the future looking like after the, you know, is it gonna be another Netflix like performance special or is there anything else that's gonna happen?
Well, we thinking about doing the second season of El Ganador, but you know, we own that. We still own that.
Wow, that's crazy, man. Well, I still have four more episodes to go. So I'm going to cry with you, laugh with you, and survive with you. That's what I like about it, because it's a roller coaster. You know what I'm saying? You go up and down, and it makes me more connected with you by watching it. You know what I'm saying? I just wish I knew how to speak Spanish, but I'm glad they got the fucking, you know.
Sometimes.
Yeah. But it's classic. It makes it real. Like, if it was in English, it would probably be fucked up.
Probably.
You gotta keep it. You know what I'm saying?
Probably, man.
Yo, I love you, man. Anytime you want to come on, man.
Hey, man. All love, man. I'm about to do a couple of shows here in my house. God bless.
Oh, you doing the live shows over there? You gonna go crazy?
Yeah.
When is your next live? When are you going on live?
No, I don't know where I'm going on live. This is like more private shows that I have, like, you know, business-wise. But, I'm planning to do a couple of interviews myself next week.
Okay.
So I want to interview J Balvin. I want to interview a couple of colleagues. Oh, May 23rd, I'm gonna have a live show.
And I will be there to check it out, man.
All love, my brother. I gotta jet now because I gotta do this. But thank you, man. Thank you for the love.
Oh, good, man. R.I.P. Chris Lighty. I don't know if you ever met him, but today is his birthday. So,
oh man,
he passed away. So good looking, hey, man.
Rest in peace, man. All love.
I love you, man. Peace. Like, damn, this guy is cool as fuck, man. Holy shit.
Sigue aquí tomándose otro tron.
This is the remix.
La vida para ti no ha sido fácil. Ha sido en el amor muy demasiado difícil. Hay algo en el que ya no te complace. Por eso sale y hace lo que hace. La vida es una y el tiempo no va a parar. Porque viste cómo se sigue amando. Baby, yo creo que el tiempo se está acabando.
Te cambió siendo mejor que ella.
Tego Calderón.
Bro, he was bigging you up, man. You gave him such a good look, and he's so humble. From a man that got, like, popularity, success, like, fans, like, on some Michael Jackson type shit. Like, he has fans that like, he don't even need all that fucking, like, extra shit. But he really loved the fact that you gave him a shot in that movie world. So.
Beautiful. You know what? When we did, when Vin had called me about Triple X, and Vin was explaining the character. And I was telling Nikki, having had met him and seen him on his social media and seeing how funny he was, when Vin described it to me, his name popped in my head, you know? So I was
automatic.
Like, it's got to be Nicky Jam because, you know, he's going to be street, but he can be funny. There's not a lot of guys that can be versatile like that. So when Nikki was like, yo, thank you very much. I appreciate you doing that for me. I was like, you know what? You did that for you because, you know what I'm saying? You paid to that picture. So, you know, Vin asked me for my opinion. And I live my opinion and what my taste is. So I made the best choice. You know what I mean? And that was what you created. That was the energy he created. You know, he's super talented.
How does it feel to be like top 10 on Netflix, though? Like when you saw that, that's crazy.
No, I'm excited, man. You know, in the beginning when they didn't come out simultaneously in the world, we were feeling a little bit of the pressure and we were kind of upset and bummed about it. But, you know.
And you're stuck in DR right now. You're stuck in Dominican Republic.
Yeah.
I mean, that's not even a problem. I wish I was stuck there.
They're sending me a plane to get out of here on Sunday. I got to go back to work. You know, I'm not even like that kind of dude where like, send me a plane, but you know, I got to get back to work. I was shooting a new series in Puerto Rico.
Mm.
Puerto Rico started to open up slowly. So I got to get back and finish some of the posts.
That's a good look, man. Is it crazy when you have to like, especially you're shooting like the personal problems of an individual. Is that tough? Like he's like explaining like his drug issues. Then you got to like put that dark side on the screen. Like, How do you get in that fucking, I guess, in that mode? Because I don't think you went through all that shit. How do you put that on the screen, though? Like, that's crazy. Like,
you know, it was, you know, we did a lot of interviews with a lot of family members and things like that. So I got a lot of the true story. And Nicki, we sat down with him a couple of times and recorded him for like hours, you know what I'm saying? And heard a lot of the story. So Nicki, when he tells it, is extremely emotional. You feel the pain when he talks about his mom. You feel the pain when he talks about certain things. You know, but Nicki was, you know, he was a producer with us on set, right? So he was helping guide some of the stuff and the information and the story. So we tried to get it as close to real. I mean, we would do scenes with him, and we would be like, oh, this is the scene where your mother, you call your mother, you're trying to find her, she calls you. He picked up the phone, and he's doing the scene, and then he just started crying. And we told him, and Nicki was like, man, I hope you got it. And I was like, no, it was the master. I was super wide. Nobody knew you were gonna cry. Like, nobody knew you were going to cry, you know what I'm saying? But the emotion, you know, it's interesting how you relive these things, you know, going back to Medellin and going back to places where it's like, this is where he was rock bottom, you know what I mean? And him having to live that moment was interesting, and that made us so much closer to the material.
You did a Luma's documentary. Is that the experience of upgrading to this, or you've always had that? Because, you know, you, I mean, you are a director, but I'm just trying to get, like,
the Maluma experience was different. Yeah. His was like a different journey. When I started working with Maluma, I started seeing like incredible growth in the way that, you know, a Justin Bieber or these young kids just fucking, you know, they start skyrocketing. But I was watching it in real time. So I was like, whoa, I know where this is going. I feel like I've seen these stories before. So I started documenting it on the rise. So I was like, you know, nobody ever does it in real time at the moment, you know? So we started documenting it, and we made a deal to, you know, just start making sure we didn't miss a moment. And I wanted to show kids, like, what it's like in this modern day. Because Maluma represents a modern day superstar, right? A kid that blows up off social media, has that fan base. He was the number one guy on Instagram, right? So it was about showing what that does and how that is, you know, and really tapping into like who he was as a person. Because a lot of people didn't know how he came up or where he came up, you know, and they misjudged him sometimes because of his like pretty boy look. So I wanted to kind of show people like who I knew as an artist, right?
In that world, it looks like there's unity, but is there like animosity amongst artists? Like, do you dwell on like issues that they have with other people, which could like design like how you would do a scene, because he's not really fucking with this artist, so you have to like put that on screen too. How is that world? Is it superficial? Are they really like holding hands and everything is beautiful? Because I feel like you have to have like a billion views to be successful in that world. Like, it's crazy. He has 2 billion views on one video. On a few videos, he has 2 billion views.
Yeah, trust me. I did some of those. So I'm in the Billy Club. I think I'm holding like 21 Billy.
you got Tekashi going crazy because he got his 2 million on
billion. That's a lot of people.
Billion.
That's a lot of people tuning in. But you know, for me, look, I feel like in the Hispanic market, at least, especially in the beginning, it was a little bit of a different vibe, you know what I'm saying? Because a lot of these Spanish cats are coming from countries where there's real heavy violence, you know? So if you look at their music is more sexual. It's like, yo, we're not promoting that because the violence in our countries is heavy. So like we're promoting I want to get the girl. I want to have sex. That's all I'm caring about. I want to have a good time, right? Yeah. Where hip hop, in some regards, people were over saturated with the violence, you know what I'm saying? And people were overly promoting violence. So, you know, it's a little bit of a different vibe, and you didn't feel that. Even though, like, sometimes artists don't get along, it wasn't like we were going to award shows and we got to worry about beef. You know what I'm saying? Like,
like 50 Cent.
That wasn't really prominent. You know what I'm saying? Not yet. But some of the new young boys now, they're getting gassed.
But the rules are real in those Spanish, like, countries and shit, because, you know, I've interviewed a lot of them, like, you know, especially like Ozuna and fucking J Balvin. Like, they're living a perfect life, but reality always is ill because they be fucking going ham down there. But they respect the street codes and they don't talk about that shit. Like, shit really goes down.
You know, I've shot all the way in every ghetto in America. Every ghetto.
I don't know how you do it, man.
Ghetto in the world, from favelas to Brazil, to Medellin, to Venezuela.
You been in La Pella? You did that. You been in La Pella? You shot in there too?
Yeah, we shot Nicki Jam in La Pella.
Oh fuck, yo!
I just shot my new TV series there.
Tego Calderon took me there, and he was like, "Yo, no police here, no police."
Nah, La Perla's cool, man. They always show love. My boy De La Ghetto is from La Perla, so you know he always opens it up, make sure we safe. But to me, it's like, you know, you shoot, like when I was shooting at Ganador, you know, I wanted to shoot at this one place where I shot a video one time where Daddy Yankee had opened up the floodgates for us.
And, oh, wow.
And I wanted to shoot there. So I was like, that's where I want to shoot, because I knew it in my mind. And they were like, not right now. You know what I'm saying? Like, they were like, there was like whatever war was going on or whatever drama, they were just like, yo, it's not safe right now, right? So, like, you get hit with those realities when you're like, I remember I was driving through Mexico on one of these jobs, and they were like, it's an hour away. And then we were like driving for an hour, and I was like, it was an hour away. They were like, oh, no, we took another route because there were some, like, bodies hanging off the highway.
Come on, man.
No joke. Like, somebody killed some people, and they hung them on, like, off, like, a freeway, like, as an example, you know? End of our people is what I'm saying.
Yeah, exactly.
Another route, so I wouldn't see that. You know what I'm saying?
Oh,
like,
wow. Yo, nah,
I lived in Mexico for 7 months doing El Ganador because we shot a lot of it there, and it's an incredible place. You know, I love shooting in Mexico. But, you know, every once in a while, you hear these war stories, and, you know, there's real drama in these countries. You know, you cannot walk around Colombia snipping. You know what I'm saying?
I still have like 6 more episodes to go, but I'm loving it, man. 13 episodes. He kind of sneaked that in. You guys might do a second part of
conversations now about the potential of doing not 13, but another chunk of episodes just to tie some things up. There was some story going, like, with his mom that we kind of just jumped to her being in the DR, but there was some real serious things that happened that led her to the Dominican Republic, you know. There was a lot of different things that people didn't know. You know, there was more information. Because when we started doing the series, the mom, she wasn't as cool with it. You know, because she comes off really bad and she wasn't as cool with it. Towards the shooting of the series, she was a little bit more open to sharing more stories, right? So when we started sharing stories, we could implement them, but not as much as we wanted to because we were already on the road. Right, so we can implement stuff, couldn't put in as much. So there was story points missing with her. There was story points missing with Nikki. There was a couple of story points that, you know, we didn't have enough time to tell. So like now, I think we can fast forward a little bit to the moment where Nikki is now in his start, and then take us back to some of the moments because there's like gaps in time that we didn't fill up. Right, so you know we have some more material.
Man, yo, I'm so, you've been busting your ass for years, man. Like, fuck everybody, man. Fuck the world. You went through, like, bullshit. And, yo, I don't give a fuck what anybody say. Every fucking body saw Soul Plane, man. I don't give a fuck what anybody say, man. You gave Kevin Hart his first fucking role. Look at him now, man. I was talking to Kevin Hart the other day. He's sleeping. He made, I think, like $1 million and change sleeping. Like,
of course. He's got so many businesses. The thing is like, you know, when Kevin walked in that room, you just felt he was a star. You know, he had the energy and the passion. You know, I always tell people, like, a lot of people call me like, yo, I'm a director, put me on. I'm like, you know what? The director I'm going to put on, he's already hot. He didn't need me to put him on. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, people, like, Kevin Hart was going to be Kevin Hart. He was going to get to where he was going, to his destination. You know what I mean? Like, he puts in the work. And you know, that for me, you know, that movie had its bumps in the road, but it turned into a little cult classic, especially in the hip hop community.
Bro, let me tell you something. I've been touring like 20 years, but you know, you know the G Unit tours and all that. But we connected with the Jay-Z's and you know their tour. We toured with them. We toured with Eminem. Everybody had Soul Plane on their tour bus. Like, that's hands down. It's either Boys in the Hood, Soul Plane. Like, you have to have that movie. You
know, hold on one second.
Oh, he's getting his poquito. All right, so I'll drink a little poquito too.
No. My daughter just went. She was knocking on the
door. Oh, I thought you were drinking some poquito or something. Hey, how you doing? Hey, that's crazy.
Jan is the star of El Ganador. She plays Nikki's little sister.
Wow, that's amazing.
So if you're watching the series, she plays a little sister.
Yo, how y'all doing?
Say hi.
Great quarantine, man. You're having a great quarantine, man. Yo, it's good to be with your family, man, during quarantine.
Yes, yes. Just sit over there. I'll be with you in a second. Bye,
bye. How is DR with the quarantining, like, rules and stuff? Is it crazy? Because DR got, like, mad issues.
I'm in a private resort in a place called Cap Cana.
Yeah.
So in Punta Cana, so right now it's like private here, so it's controlled. You know, they have their own supermarket, their own gas station. They you know, check your temperature before you go to the supermarket. They make
Are you serious?
Gloves. Yeah. So it's pretty safe here. You know, I don't venture out much, so yeah, I can still walk to the beach. I can still ride my bike. You know, so. I've been lucky. I'm in a fortunate place, you know?
How's the balancing of, like, because Haiti, I heard Haiti's not letting Dominicans in because of some secret government disease plus this. Like, is that real? What is that about?
I don't know. I mean, you know, ever since the earthquakes in Haiti, you know, a lot of the Haitians came over here to work and stuff like that. There was a big influx of Haitians, which I know some of the Dominicans were not happy about. But for me, when I travel and I go around to the restaurants, I meet a lot of Haitians, you know? So people say there's that hate, but then I don't see it, you know? So I'm not sure, you know? There's a lot of, like, this and that, and, you know, they make things so much extra, you know, than they need to be, you know? But I haven't heard that about them not letting people across the border. Now, during the coronavirus, for sure. I know
We might as well get to the nitty-gritty, man. Wangsta video. Many men. You did Candy Shop. You made 50 mad money with those videos, man. Like, but the Wangsta video to me is the funniest because I was wondering where the hell they get that Ja Rule doll from, man. Like, where did that doll come from? Like, what's the secret behind that Ja Rule doll, yo? I mean, the beef is way like 20 years ago, but where did that? Who got that doll? Like,
now we made the doll. We made. You know, it was an idea that we had. You know, we knew that the beef was brewing or whatever, and you know, I made the idea, and then when I saw the doll, I was like, I don't know, we gotta go there. You know what I'm saying? Sometimes, like, you know, but when I saw it, but then 50 saw the doll and he wanted to run with it. 50 saw the doll and he wanted to run with it. He was like, let's go, let's, you know. And remember, his son Marquise was the one playing with the doll.
Yeah, how is it to, like, you're a director and you're zooming in on this doll? Like, what was going on in your head, man? Like, I mean, this is wild, yo.
I'm from Queens. I'm like, this doll's about to get me in a lot of trouble, too.
Yo, Robert De Niro, man. Like, was that one of your big moments in your directorial career? Like, hanging with Robert De Niro? Like,
I mean, it was incredible for me, honestly. Like, look, I think a lot of what I'm doing right now is stems from being around 50, right? If you look what I'm doing on a smaller scale, I'm following in the power footsteps, you know? Like, for me and 50 created when we did Gun. Remember, 50 told me to do Gun, and when we did Gun was a super low-budget movie.
I know, yeah, Torre, you had that Mexican homie on there, right? With all the tats.
Yeah.
He's the homie, though. So he's mad cool.
When we did that movie, we did it for $2 million. We did it for no money.
Oh,
we
shot
in 14 days, and Fifth was like, yo, I got a real big plan to get into the film and TV business. Let's do it. It was October. And then he was like, I was like, okay, when do we shoot? He was like, December. I'm like, it's October, Fifth. You need December. But he was like, look, during Christmas and New Year's, while everybody's on vacation, we're going to go make this money. So we went and we did the movie. The movie was successful. We flipped it. We turned it around. And then Freelancers was the next movie when he raised more money. So Loyalty came to me first and said, yo, let's do it again. Right? And this time we had more money. It was bigger. So when I was part of that cycle with him, I saw what he was doing and what he was creating. Right? So I took that same energy and I said, I'm going to apply this to the Latin market. So I started going hard and doing stuff, the Maluma movie, the Nicki Jam series. Now I got a new series coming on YouTube. So I've been doing the same thing. And I don't got the visibility Fifth got, but, you know, I'm finding my way. You know what I'm saying?
No,
and I'm
like
working and I'm working and I'm working and I'm eventually going to get there. But I took that page off out of his book and I took that battery. You know what I mean? I saw him do it. I was part of it. And then I just stemmed off to do my own thing, you know what I'm saying? And I hope, you know, I saw 50 the other day. I hope he's proud because, like, I'm out there grinding.
And then, of course, you've created, like, an extension. Like, your cinema giants, you don't need to be everywhere because you have your own, like, production company with other producers that you trust to catch other projects, right?
We have other directors. My goal is like, look, at some point we get into a position of power where it's like our turn to bring up the next generation. You know what I'm saying? And you know what? It was hard for me. Nobody opened the doors. There wasn't a Jesse Torero in front of me, some other Dominican kid I could look up to. Those characters didn't exist. But just because they didn't give me the hand don't mean I can't put the hand back. You know what I'm saying? So the same way I did get opportunities because guys like 50 came around and, you know what, empowered a guy like me. You know what I'm saying? So it's like I'm trying to empower that new generation and bring them up and show them that, you know what, you don't got to go through all the hardships that I went through. I can show you a faster way and a faster route to get into the movie business, to get into the TV business, because you can't do music videos forever. You know what I'm saying?
Like, exactly.
That's like
staying. I mean, you learn that from Hype Williams, man. Like Hype Williams, like little X. Well, he's Director X now. So
yeah.
You got to upgrade yourself. Did you look up to those guys, especially you coming from the video?
No, but music for video me, background? I think everybody looked up to Hype, right? Yeah. Hype Williams, hey, come on.
She over there breakdancing, man. You look like that news reporter with the kid in the back right now.
They, you know, everybody looked up to Hype. I don't think there was anybody, it would be a mistake for people to say they didn't look up to Hype. It's so funny because one day, I didn't meet Hype Williams till like one day, like in a nightclub. You know, this was like years later, right? Like Hype was big. At this point, I was already big, candy shopped out, doing big videos. And I'm at a nightclub in LA and somebody's like, there was no tables. So I had like a section with like two tables. So they were like, yo, Williams is walking in with the guys from FUBU. You mind if they sit next to me? I'm like, I don't know Hype Williams though. You know what I'm saying? It's like, but I say, you know what? I know of Hype and I respect him. So if you walk him over here, I'm gonna say what's up because I love Hype Williams. Yeah. I just don't know him. You can't assume we all knew each other. You know what I'm saying? Because Hype was always like a bigger figure. I never really saw him, and it was like cliquish. And I was part of like Chris Robinson's clique.
Oh, okay.
Chris Robinson, Diane Martel. Now, I met Benny Boom and Little X. I was part of the Hype crew because they were, like, closer to me in the sense of starting out. But Hype, by the time I was getting in the game, he was already, like, this figure that was so big that I never really got around him, you know? But,
Aren't you mad that you didn't get, like, the label budgets back then? They had, like, $1 million budgets for videos.
Yeah.
You don't even see that anymore. Like, Hype Williams really milked it. Like the Busta and Janet Jackson videos, it was $1 million, and now you can do that shit on Instagram with your fucking, like an app and shit. Like, shit is crazy.
It's interesting because right now, like once I got in the game, the video started to decline. It was like, when I was working underneath Chris Robinson, he was getting to the point where they were like $1 million and then they started to decline. So by the time I was coming, you know, we maybe got up to $500,000, but that was like, but look, for me, a kid from Jamaica, Queens, it was incredible money. Sometimes it's better not to have gotten spoiled because some of those guys got so spoiled when they try to transfer their career to television or film, it hurt them because their egos couldn't like shift. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, wow.
I always used to tell Chris, I was like, you know what? I did a short film early and then that led to Soul Plane. So I did Soul Plane way before my music video career was so big, you know, because I was, I always wanted to get into the film business before my ego got too big in music videos, because then I couldn't transfer it over. Because when you get into the film business, they're looking at you like, yo, you make 5-minute videos, dog. Like, that's cool. But are you going to keep people entertained for 2 hours? Like, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, you're a sprinter. This is a marathon. Now you're running with marathon runners. Like, you ain't even trained. You're not conditioned for this game. You know?
Yeah. That's real talk though. Like, you know, a lot of people they get like so lost because they feel like they have to be like given like certain projects where it's beneath them to fucking deal with like little music videos and shit like that. But you found the balance though. You know. I just want all the like cuts that didn't make the movie. Like I asked Kevin Hart, I asked Monique, I asked like so many like artists from that movie, and there's like special cuts that you have that are hilarious, that didn't make the fuck. I need you to send that to me so I can just fucking just laugh on my
own. Trust me, I was getting so much flack just from like certain people in the black community because they were like, oh, it's too edgy, the movie.
Yeah, exploiting, blah, 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 yeah.
So there were scenes that like Monique would do with Tom sometimes, and like the way they would improvise and the jokes between like white and black or whatever. And I'm like, man, I can't use none of this stuff, you know. And Monique would be like, stop being scared. You scared. Don't be a bitch. And I'm like, I can't use that. I can't use that. They're already trying to crucify me, you know?
But then it gets you mad because then a couple of years later, Dave Chappelle comes out and he's so raw. He don't give a fuck.
But you make decisions. But look, every decision I made, the decision was soul playing. It was an amazing moment in my life. It taught me a lot. Some of the backlash helped me grow. Because I was like, oh, wow, I understood how the industry can just turn on you in 1 second. And I was like, all right, this is cool. But Kevin and Snoop and Monique and everybody supported me, so that was great. And then, you know, I saw Fifth, when I did the movies with Fifth. Fifth showed me a whole other side of the business where you don't like, you know what, forget Hollywood. We go do this shit ourselves, you know?
Yeah, do it on
your
own. That
kind of mentality got me to do El Ganador. Like, for 2 years, I was trying to direct television, and they were like, you got to get into a minority program. You got to go do this. You got to go do that. And I'm like, my camera's not a Spanish camera. Like, I'm using the same camera the other dude is using. Why I got to join the minority program? I already got 3 movies under my belt. I did a movie run, but I can't do television?
No.
You know? So I was like, I did an episode of The Office as like a shadowing program. So I did 1 episode, and I had to do a couple more. And I was like, I love The Office, but I'm like, I can't do this. Because some of the directors they got coming in might not even have the experience I have. So I was like, you know what? I'm going to go make my own TV show. And a lot of people were like, yeah, right. Good luck with that. And, you know, a couple of years later, I got Nicky Jam. So, you know, from now on, I'm like, exactly. I'm making TV shows.
Before you go, yo, a lot of people, like, especially a lot of my friends, they want, like, a gangster, like, Dominican gangster movie or Haitian movie, like, somewhere, like, Caribbean. I mean, the last one was, like, what, Top Shotter? I don't know, but we need, like, some like gritty, like gangster, true like kind of like, you know, what's that movie in Brazil that came out that was like classic? It was all in Spanish too, but it was they were gangster little kids. That was
what's the name of that?
Yeah, City of God. But we need a Dominican, like a DR or a Haitian gangster movie, like
I'm working on that. I'm working on that now.
Please,
I'm working on that now. I signed a director in the Dominican Republic named Rodrigo Films, who's like, you know, he did that Bad Bunny, Alpha record, La Romana, that's super big. And he's been doing all the like hot young kids out here. So I've been talking to him because I'm like, he's in that culture so heavy that I'm like, you know what? Let's develop a project here. So we've been developing something. So we're, you know, hopefully going to take it to market soon. But it's you're going to like it. Some gangster stuff.
Yo, today is Chris Lighty's birthday, man. You ever interact with Chris Lighty?
Yes, birthday to Chris Lighty, man. Rest in peace. My brother, we had some great journeys together.
Yeah, man. He actually put a lot of people on, man. And it's everybody's interconnected to Chris Lighty, man. So I'm glad, you know, look at you and look at me. We're all like success stories, man.
Yeah, man.
In our own way. Thanks for hooking me up with Nicky Jam, too, man. That was a good look, man.
Thank you, man. And I appreciate you helping us out and putting the word out and promoting. You know, we want everybody to see. We definitely want the hip-hop community to jump in and see El Ganador. Some people get a little bit, you know, because it's in Spanish. Yeah. But it's great when a lot of people have been consuming it. Snoop hit me. He told me, like, yo. He was like, yo, just
go. I mean, yo, people watch Narcos. Narcos is in Mexican. Yo, people will watch this shit. As long as this shit is cool. Like, reality is the best thing right now. You know what I'm saying? You know, niggas ain't fucking with fiction right now. Reality and like, we're all stuck. This is a reality right now. So we need like, see, like some kind of like documentary style where we can like connect with whoever we're watching. Like, we're not into like aliens and spaceships and shit right now because we can't go outside. You know what I'm saying? So it's I think it's a perfect timing for you to drop like this series. You know what I'm saying? Like, more power too.
That I feel blessed that we were able to drop it now, and I'm excited that the community starting to respond to it.
Yeah.
Especially like a non-Spanish speaking community, because I want to, you know, I try to do it with American sensibility, so I felt like everybody could tap into the story. So it is a story that's in Spanish, but it's an American story that anybody could feel. Like anybody that grew up in the streets of New York knows people that went through that level of pain, you know what I'm saying, and that level of struggle. So I'm glad everybody's jumping in, and I appreciate you putting the word out, and you know, always love, man. It's always good to see you, my brother. Keep doing it.
Oh, man. Yeah, I love you, man. And I'm glad you're enjoying yourself with your family, man, out there, man, in this crazy time, man. All right, you're in DR. I wish I was in DR right now.
All right. Thank you, my brother. Much love, man. Peace.
Peace out, my brother. Love. Yo, man. Another cool guy, man. Jesus.